कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा डियर डिवोटीज प्लीज एक्सेप्ट माय हम्बल ऑबेसेंसेस ऑल ग्लोरीज टू श्रीला प्रभुपाद एंड गुरुदेव टुडे वी हैव श्रीदेवी माताजी शी इज गोइंग टू एनलाइटन अस ऑन द टॉपिक ऑफ श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 1 चैप्टर 2 वर्स 18 माताजी हरे कृष्णा माताजी Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and Gurudev. Thank you, Mataji, for your time and association today. Just give me a minute. I will share the screen, Mataji. Yes.
Thank you. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to Gurudev. And this is again because Guru Maharaj has requested me to give the class. He will be giving class tomorrow. He will be speaking on Janakinath Prabhu. And we may even see Janakinath Prabhu. That's the plan. So please bear with me. Sorry that you may be disappointed. Guru Maharaj is not there, but I'm simply doing this as a service to Guru Maharaj and to you all. Thank you very much. ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये नष्टप्रायेष्व अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवती उत्तमा श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी My humble obeisances to all the Vaishnavas, Vancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha, Kripa Sindhubhyaiva cha, Patitanam Pavanibhyo, Vaishnavebhyo, Namo Namaha. So Guru Maharaj requested me to speak on the importance of reading and studying the Shastras every day. So I was thinking, which verse should I speak on? And I remembered this particular verse, which is actually what I'm going to speak on, text 18 of the second chapter of the first canto. But before that, I would like us to look at these translations because this whole section 1 to 16 to 20 is so beautifully translated and written by Srila Prabhupada. So we will read all these translations first and then we will go into the verse. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदामयं ददाति स्वपदादिकम् So here we are. Can everyone see the screen? I hope everybody can see the screen. Okay. Text number 16. O twice born sages, by serving those devotees who are completely freed from all vice, great service is done. By such service, one gains affinity for hearing the messages of Vasudev. Text 17. Sri Krishna, the personality of Godhead, who is the Paramatma, super soul in everyone's heart, and the benefactor of the truthful devotee, cleanses desire for material enjoyment from the heart of the devotee who has developed the urge to hear his messages, which are in themselves virtuous when properly heard and chanted. Text 18. By regular attendance in classes on the Bhagavatam and by rendering of service to the pure devotee, all that is troublesome to the heart is almost completely destroyed, and loving service unto the personality of Godhead, who's praised with transcendental songs, is established as an irrevocable fact. Text 19. As soon as irrevocable loving service is established in the heart, the effect of nature's modes of passion and ignorance, such as lust, desire, and hankering, disappear from the heart. Then the devotee is established in goodness and he becomes completely happy. Text 20. Thus established in the mode of unalloyed goodness, the man whose mind has been enlivened by contact with devotional service to the Lord gains positive scientific knowledge of the personality of Godhead in the stage of liberation from all material association. Jai. Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. So now I would like us to go to text 18. Thank you, Vrinda. And let's take a look at this beautiful verse. It goes like this. Nashta prayeshu abhadreshu nityam bhagvata sevaya bhagvati uttama shloke bhaktir bhakti naishtiki. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. By regular attendance in classes on the Bhagavatam and by rendering of service to the pure devotee, all that is troublesome to the heart is almost completely destroyed, and loving service unto the personality of Godhead, who's praised with transcendental songs, is established as an irrevocable fact. Purport. Here is the remedy for eliminating all inauspicious things within the heart, which are considered to be obstacles in the path of self-realization. The remedy is the association of the Bhagavatas. There are two types of Bhagavatas, namely the book Bhagavat and the devotee Bhagavat. Both the Bhagavatas are competent remedies, and both of them or either of them can be good enough to eliminate the obstacles. A devotee Bhagavat is as good as the book Bhagavat, because the devotee Bhagavat leads his life in terms of the book Bhagavat, and the book Bhagavat is full of information about the personality of Godhead and his pure devotees who are also Bhagavats. Bhagavat, book, and person are identical. The devotee Bhagavat is a direct representative of Bhagavan, the personality of Godhead. So, by pleasing the devotee Bhagavat, one can receive the benefit of the book Bhagavat. Human reason fails to understand how by serving the devotee Bhagavat or the book Bhagavat, one gets gradual promotion on the path of devotion. But actually, these are facts explained by Srila Narada Dev, who happened to be a maidservant's son in his previous life. The maidservant was engaged in the menial service of the sages, and thus he also came into contact with them. And simply associating with them and accepting the remnants of foodstuff left by the sages, the son of the maidservant got the chance to become the great devotee and personality, Srila Narada Dev. These are the miraculous effects of the association of Bhagavatas. And to understand these effects practically, it should be noted that by such sincere association of the Bhagavatas, one is sure to receive transcendental knowledge very easily, with the result that he becomes fixed in the devotional service of the Lord. The more progress is made in devotional service under the guidance of the Bhagavatas, the more one becomes fixed in the transcendental loving service of the Lord. The messages of the book Bhagavat, therefore, have to be received from the devotee Bhagavat, and the combination of these two Bhagavatas will help the neophyte devotee to make progress on and on. Thank you, Linda. So here we have a very beautiful description of what happens by regular attendance in classes on Srimad Bhagavatam. What happens? All that is troublesome to the heart is almost completely destroyed. And loving service unto the personality of Godhead, who's praised with transcendental songs, becomes established as an irrevocable fact. So Srila Prabhupada is giving a beautiful explanation, or rather the remedy. He calls it the remedy because we are all in a diseased condition. Being in this material world, we are all conditioned by the material energy. We are hopelessly entangled in the various modes of goodness, passion, ignorance, sometimes one predominating, sometimes another predominating. We're just entangled like fish caught in a net. And how to get disentangled and how to come back to our real position, which is what? Loving, pure, eternal servant of Krishna is being described over here. We are beset by troubles and difficulties, especially because this age of Kali is so difficult. And we have the three miseries attacking us all the time. So how can we remain unaffected? How can we rise above the material miseries? by coming onto the transcendental platform. And how do we get onto the transcendental platform is described over here. There's a process. It's a scientific process for disentangling ourselves from the material energy and coming back to who we really are. Who are we really? Satchit Ananda Vigraha. We are made in the image of Krishna. We are eternal, we are blissful, we are full of knowledge and full of love, and we are eternally servitors of Krishna, nothing else. Nothing else but that. But we forget that because the material energy is so powerful and she bewilders us. So we are constantly trying to lord it over material nature, while on the other hand, material nature has us in her stringent hands and is subjecting us with the whips of material existence. But there is a way to get free. There is a way to become situated in our original position, and that is the process that is being described over here. What is that? Pleasing the pure devotee of the Lord, the pure spiritual master who's the representative of the Lord. And why is he the pure representative? Because he's following the book Bhagavat. That means he's following the Shastras to the letter. He's following his spiritual master to the letter, who is coming in the disciplic succession. And so because he is perfect in his execution of devotional service, because he's engaged 24 hours simply in the service of the Lord, he's situated on the transcendental platform, he can guide the neophyte devotee back home, back to Godhead, how to follow the process, where not to make mistakes, which are the pitfalls to be avoided, which are the dangers to be avoided, what are the anarthas to be overcome. The pure spiritual master is personally empowered by the Lord to guide the devotee back home, back to Godhead. So he has divine vision, and he can give complete guidance, complete instructions to take us back home, back to Godhead. So that is why we follow the pure representative of the Lord, because he can bring us back to Krishna. And that's where we want to go. We want to go back home, back to Godhead. So the devotee Bhagavat is giving us the process, is giving us the knowledge, is giving us the information, how to make our lives perfect. So what are the means by which to do it? And this is the process. Chanting, hearing, shravanam, kirtanam, vishnu, smaranam, pada sevanam, vandanam, dasyam, archanam, sakhyam, atmanivedanam. 9 processes of bhakti, beginning with hearing and chanting. This is very, very important. And hearing, shravanam, is the foundation for all the other 7 processes. Everything is based on hearing carefully, understanding carefully, and applying the knowledge that we have been given intelligently, so that we gain greater and greater clarity, we gain greater understanding, and we gain realizations. Actually, hearing is very important because this forms the basis for getting more and more attracted to the process of devotional service. So both these Bhagavatas, the book Bhagavat and the devotee Bhagavat, are equally competent, and both of them together make the process perfect. So we want to remove all the anarthas in our hearts. We want to clear ourselves. We want to do cheta darpana marjanam, cleansing the mirror of the heart. So how do we do that? By daily hearing the messages of the personality of Godhead, who has come in the form of these wonderful transcendental literatures written by the most pure, powerful, empowered commander-in-chief of Lord Chaitanya, Srila Prabhupada. He is known as Senapati Bhakta by Lord Chaitanya himself, who called him, "My Senapati Bhakta will come and spread my holy name and spread this message everywhere." So Srila Prabhupada is a specially empowered representative. And why has Srila Prabhupada written so many books? It is for us. And because it was a command of Krishna. I will talk about that a little further down. Let's finish with this second paragraph of the purport. So the devotee Bhagavat is a direct representative. By pleasing the devotee Bhagavat, we can receive the benefit of the book Bhagavad. So we want to get the blessings so that we can actually grasp the knowledge, actually apply ourselves to this transcendental knowledge that's available in these books. Human reason fails to understand how by serving the devotee Bhagavat or the book Bhagavat, one gets gradual promotion on the path of devotion. This is because everything cannot be understood with the intellect. Transcendental knowledge, transcendental processes are above the plane of intellectual mental speculation. They are out of the realm of the material. They exist on the spiritual platform. So therefore, this process is given by Krishna himself, and the pure devotee representative comes to teach us how to make our lives perfect. And this knowledge, which is there in the books, is completely pure. It is apaurusheya. That means it is not man-made. It is coming from Krishna. These facts are explained by Narada Dev. Now, Narada Dev, who was Narad Muni? In his previous birth, he was just a humble servant, maidservant's son. But it so happened that the saintly devotees who were resting in one place for Chaturmasya, the 4 months of the rainy season, they took shelter in a particular place. And this little maidservant lady would go to help in the household chores, cleaning, doing things for them, for their comfort. And so this little boy, her son, would accompany her, and he would be hearing these great sages constantly reciting the glories of the Lord. Because he was constantly hearing, his desire for further and further knowledge developed. Then he took the remnants of the foodstuffs left by the saintly devotees, and that was so purifying, he became fixed in the service of the Lord, and he had understood the process of devotional service at the age of 5 years. When his mother passed away suddenly due to a snake bite, he went into meditation because he followed the instructions, because he had heard very, very carefully the instructions of the great devotees. So this is how we want to be also in our Krishna consciousness. We want to become fixed up. Now, right now, we are wavering still. We are in and out. We are unsteady. We are falling down. We are picking ourselves up unsteadily. We are crawling. And Prabhupada said, yes, in the beginning stages, you're like an infant. You will fall down. You will get back up again. You'll fall down. You'll get back up again. But keep going. And one day you will be walking. You will be running. So this is the assurance given to us by Srila Prabhupada. So we may feel discouraged from time to time, but by hearing that, yes, you will come to the platform of perfection, doesn't matter, even if it takes many, many lifetimes, we just keep plugging on and on and on, no matter what the challenges, no matter what the difficulties, we just keep to the process because we have this assurance from Prabhupada. So just as Narada Muni made his life perfect, we can make our lives perfect too. These are the miraculous effects of the association of Bhagavats. And we can see in the Shastras, there are so many instances where simply by coming in contact with the pure devotee of the Lord, how everything changed for that person. Look at Mrigari Hunter. Look at Valmiki. Who was Valmiki? He was just a hunter and he was killing animals. And then Narad Muni comes and gives him the Ram mantra. He says, say Ram. But he's such a fallen person, he cannot even say Ram. And Narad Muni, understanding this person just knows how to kill animals, he says, okay, say Mara, 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 Mara over and over again. And then that Mara, 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 Mara becomes Rama, 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 Rama. And then this hunter became the great sage Valmiki. So we can take assurance, we can take heart from what we read in the scripture. That is why it is so important for us to daily get in touch with these holy books. Because Srila Prabhupada said, I have not written these books. Krishna has written these books. I'm simply writing it down. But Krishna is coming and dictating to me. And that is how these books are getting written. And even I myself read my books. When Prabhupada says that, what about us? And we can get Prabhupada's association by reading these books, because he said, my purports are my devotional ecstasies. Because Prabhupada took so much pains to write these books. He sat up late into the night. He consulted so many different commentaries by the great acharyas. He condensed everything. And then he applied his knowledge of the present situation, the present world situation, the present mentality, especially of the Western world, and presented it so nicely, so interestingly, so that it captures the mind and heart when we read Prabhupada's books, isn't it? We get so much captivated by the messages of the pure devotee as he's writing them, because he only wants one thing. He wants us to be happy. He wants us to come back to Krishna. He wants us to have perfect love. And that is only available when we take to the spiritual path. So we want to become fixed. And how does that happen? By applying this process, by sincerely associating with both the book Bhagavat and the devotee Bhagavat, the result is that he becomes fixed in the devotional service of the Lord. Then slowly, slowly, more and more progress is made under the guidance of the Bhagavats, and one becomes even more fixed in the transcendental loving service of the Lord. So the messages of the book Bhagavat, therefore, have to be received from the devotee Bhagavat. And the combination of these two Bhagavats will help the devotee, neophyte devotee, to make progress on and on and on. So Srila Prabhupada wrote these books for us at such an advanced age because he wanted us to get free of the clutches of the material energy and be situated in perfect knowledge, perfect understanding, perfect clarity, and then perfect application. Because once you have mastered something, then you can apply it very nicely. How does Srila Prabhupada want us to read these books? Prabhupada said, I want everyone to read my books 1 to 2 hours daily with full absorption, very scrutinizingly. What is the meaning of this word, scrutinizingly? That means not just read, but read with deep absorption, really trying to understand the subject matter. Of course, it's not very easy to understand. It's very high level stuff, as we say. But if you simply read over and over and over again, slowly, slowly, things start becoming clear. What we didn't understand in the beginning becomes a little more clear at the second reading, a little more clear at the third reading. And then we start gaining an affinity for understanding the subject matter because we can see how it is changing our hearts, how it is transforming our life, how it is changing our relationships, how it is making us more effective, how it is making us better instruments for this great mission of Lord Chaitanya, who has come to save the whole world. Lord Chaitanya wants everyone to come back home. He doesn't want us to be rotting in this material world, which is just a shadow world, which is not the reality of it. He wants us to be back with Krishna, singing and dancing and jumping and playing and running and doing all wonderful things to please Krishna in the spiritual world, in our eternal, beautiful spiritual forms. Why not? Why shouldn't we go back? Of course, we should try to go back. So we want to hear about the spiritual world. We want to hear about Krishna. We want to read about his pastimes. We want to understand the messages of the Lord, because he wants us back home, back with him. And this is the process to do that. By reading, we gain knowledge, we gain understanding, we gain realization. And then questions arise in the heart. And then we can ask those questions and get our doubts cleared by the pure devotee of the Lord, who is situated in transcendence and who can answer all questions and destroy all the nations in our hearts. And actually, Krishna wants this, and he promises. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yena mam upayantite. To those who are constantly devoted to serving me with love, I give the understanding by which they can come to me. And then the next verse, I think it says, to give them special mercy. I, dwelling in their hearts, destroy with the shining lamp of knowledge the darkness born of ignorance. So Krishna will come and cleanse our heart. He will light up our hearts and he will show us the way back home. He will give us the intelligence, how to act in different situations, how to conduct ourselves, what to do, what not to do. Everything becomes clear by following the process of bhakti. And that is why it is so important for us to daily hear from the pure devotee of the Lord, to daily read the books of the pure devotee of the Lord, and following the instructions to engage in devotional service and make our life perfect. So I want to read one particular quote from Srila Prabhupada's letter that he wrote, because it's so wonderful. If you will kindly permit me, I will read it. This is a letter to his disciple, and it goes like this. It's written from Los Angeles, 13 June 1972. I don't know if, Vrinda, do you think I can screen share?
Yes, Mataji, I will stop it and you can.
Yeah, that would be nice so that everybody can read along with me. If you can allow me to screen share, then I can put it up and then I can just read the relevant section of this very beautiful letter that Prabhupada wrote to his disciple. I'll just read, it's a long letter, so we are going to go straight. Okay, I'm going to highlight it so you can see where I'm at. So I'm requesting all of my students to read my books very seriously every day without fail. In this way, if your mind becomes absorbed at least 1 or 2 hours daily in the transcendental subject matter of Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, and other books, then very easily you will make your advancement in Krishna consciousness. It is not a matter of changing our engagement, adjusting this or that material condition in order to find our real happiness. Krishna consciousness is not like that. Then, and this another point which I want to make, here it is. The restlessness or agitation of the mind cannot be rectified by altering the material circumstances. If we are Krishna conscious, any type of occupation will suit me and we shall always be satisfied. Therefore, I recommend you to read books more and more and try to understand the subject matter from different angles of vision and always be discussing it with your God brothers, even while you are working at the press. And when you are working and you cannot read, then listen to the tapes of my lectures and hear in that way. And never neglect to chant your 16 rounds of beads daily. Rise early without fail, attend Mangalarti, take bath, follow other regulative principles, and everything will come out very successfully. You can rest assured of that. So see how much assurance Srila Prabhupada is giving us, because we are very small, we are like little babies, we are little toddlers, we are still struggling just to stand up. I mean, those of you who have seen little babies, you can see how they are, you know, they're first crawling, then they're just trying to hold on to something and stand up. Then they're tottering and they're shaking on shaky legs and then holding on to the furniture. They start moving sideways. And then after a little while, they'll hold somebody's hand and take their first few unsteady steps. So we are like that. We are just struggling to just get our balance, practically speaking, because every little thing throws us off balance. But we can rest assured by hearing from Srila Prabhupada, by reading his books, and by taking shelter of the guidance of the spiritual master who has come from the spiritual world to take us back home, back to Krishna. So I think I have completed, maybe I have 1 or 2 more quotes from Srila Prabhupada. Let me see. And then we can open it up for discussion, because I think this is a very important subject matter. Okay, I want to share a little anecdote about Srila Prabhupada, how he came to the material world. Srila Prabhupada was with Krishna, and Krishna said, you go to the material world, And Srila Prabhupada said, material world, horrible place. Who wants to go to the material world, such a horrible place? So Krishna said, no, you go, you write some books, I will be with you. So then Srila Prabhupada, on that condition that Krishna would always be with him and protect him and not let him fall down, came here down to the spiritual world just to help us by writing these books and giving us the knowledge of the spiritual world, to teach us what is the spiritual world, to teach us who is Krishna, to teach us the process of devotional service and take us back home. In fact, Srila Prabhupada said that this instruction of his spiritual master went very deep into his heart. This was the time when Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Maharaj was feeling great unrest because his disciples were fighting over, you know, this big marble building, and he was very concerned about the future, and he turned to Prabhupada and said, there will be fire. There will be fire in the mat, because he could foretell what was coming. And then he looked at Prabhupada and he said, if you ever get money, print books. This was the instruction given. And Prabhupada took that very seriously. With great difficulty, he started Back to Godhead magazine. And I don't know if you have read Leelamrita, but if you can just look up just how much trouble Srila Prabhupada took to type up, to print, and to distribute that Back to Godhead magazine, going from tea stall to tea stall, trying to get people to just take something. And then one person sitting over there said, why do you want to publish it like this? You know, people will just read it and throw it. It's like a newsletter. Why don't you publish it in the form of a book? So Prabhupada took that very seriously and then decided to start printing books. And if you read that part of Leelamrita, where he used to go to the Chippiwada temple and then go to the printer in the hot blazing New Delhi sun. Once he even fell down in a faint on the streets of New Delhi, he was gored by a bull. What not Prabhupada went through just to give us transcendental knowledge, just to give this message of going back home, back to Godhead. It sends shivers down your spine when you think about what Prabhupada did to give us these books. So it is so important for us to take this knowledge and then to distribute it to others. So thank you very much for listening very patiently. I will now open it up for comments, realizations, discussions, corrections. My humble obeisances to all my dear God brothers and sisters. If I have in some way disappointed you or annoyed you, please forgive me. I'm just trying to do my service. I'm also very small, struggling. Please forgive me. Hare Krishna. Nitesh Prabhu, you have a question?
Hare Krishna Mataji, please accept my humble obeisances. All
you
glory
to mine.
Mataji, that was a wonderful class, and I think you need this dosage on a regular basis to understand why we need to read and what Srila Prabhupada has gone through to give us what he has done, the importance and the significance. So thank you for this class and the topic chosen. Mataji, I have two questions. So the first is...
it would be nice to see you, Dinesh Prabhu.
I'm in a car, not in a good environment.
That's okay. No,
I normally do, but sorry, Mataji. So the question is, Mataji, let me rephrase my question properly. Nowadays, when we speak to devotees of the second generation or the third generation or new generation, especially, they are more inclined to reading light reading, not really Srila Prabhupada's books, but, you know, books written by other authors within ISKCON. And they tend to go there, and that's where they find their answers. That's where they're more inclined and keen. And when I come across those individuals or when I come across preachings, I always sort of refer to, please read Srila Prabhupada's books first. And then for secondary information, you can reach out to those books. Or I tell them that, you know, you should, you know, if you're inclined to read some other Maharaj's book or other author's book within ISKCON, do that, but don't give up reading Srila Prabhupada's books, have you come across the situations, and how do you, what's the, how do we rightly convey the message when we are preaching? Because we you know, in UK, we come across, we have many of those small books that are published by many other devotees, which are good, but then devotees are inclined just to read those and not read Prabhupada's books. That's my first question. And the second question, is there a, from your experience, and I know it's very personal as to what works well for one individual, but what can you share some tips of what is a structured way of reading Srila Prabhupada's books?
Very great questions. You asked such a two very deep questions. First and foremost, I'm not sure that I can answer you with any knowledge, because I have not been in a temple like yours. Yours is a very big temple. There are a lot of young people who are reading different things, doing different things. It's a very different temple. I was in a very rural, isolated farm community where there were hardly any young people. If they showed up at the temple, you know, it was like a celebration. They would just come for Sunday feast, do kirtan, and that was it. So I don't know how to answer your first question, how to encourage young people to read Prabhupada's books first, rather than pick up, you know, some odd things here and there. Let me just pray about this before I talk. Your second question is actually very important for me, because even I'm trying to understand how best to read Prabhupada's books, how best to structure it. So I will just share with you what my mentor told me, because when I told her, this is such a challenge, you know, for me, to set aside time, to sit with the book, to get absorbed in it when, you know, I feel there are 100 other things that I would rather do, or which in my misguided mind, I think that is, this is more important or that is more important, but this is what Prabhupada wants us to do. So what are the things she's, not that I'm applying it, I'm still struggling to apply it, but I'll share with you what she said. She said, keep a small notebook. Keep your pen handy. Start reading. Just do it. When I was telling her what a challenge, she said, just do it. Even if it's 15 minutes, even if it's 20 minutes, sit with that book, sit with your pen and notepad and start reading. As something strikes you, write it down. Because you will find that when your heart feels happy or satisfied or feels solace or comfort by reading a particular line, later on, when some situation happens, you will go back to that paragraph. You will want to read it up. So write down the verse number, write down the purport or the translation, where it is. Write it down on a little notepad and keep it with you. And it should be small enough to go into your purse or your briefcase or whatever it is. Not like a great big heavy diary or anything. Just something small so you can quickly refer to it also. Then she said, try to discuss what you have read, you know, if you can have one or two God brothers or God sisters in the reading group, you can bring it to the group and say, this is what I read. This is what struck me. This is what I felt was very important to my situation, like that. And as you share more, actually, we learn more when we teach. That's where they say that, you know, if you really want to master something, teach it to someone, because that forces you to go deeper. So I'm not saying I'm very good at this. I'm just sharing with you what my mentor told me. I'm still trying to apply it myself, but I have actually started on her advice, keeping a small little, tiny little diary in which I write down, you know, a particular verse. And that goes for a few days. I am able to do it. Then again, I fall by the wayside and it gets off track. So I think it's a question of repeatedly trying to get regulated and get situated in a practice of reading. And it takes, believe me, it takes work to get there. It takes work because our Kali Yuga brains, first and foremost, are very restless and agitated. We don't understand how to manage our day properly, our time, our energies. We are very distracted. But if we make an attempt, I do believe Guru and Srila Prabhupada and Krishna will help us to get into the reading habit, because this reading habit is so important. I cannot stress how important it is to be in touch with Prabhupada's books, because Kali Yuga is very, very heavy and we can easily get away from the process of devotional service. Coming back to your first question, how to encourage young people? I'm just thinking, if I were in that situation, you know, I wouldn't say anything to them at first. I wouldn't say anything, because young people, first and foremost, don't like to take directions from others, especially, you know, even if we are older or senior or something, they don't like to hear anything from us. What I would like to do is probably offer a seminar or offer a workshop or offer something that will draw them in with nice prasadam or something like that, and then speak about the importance of Prabhupada's books, giving them an opportunity to ask questions, and then impressing on them the necessity to go deep into Prabhupada's books. Because just telling something to them is not going to work. They're not going to listen, first and foremost, and they may even get offended. Unless it's, you know, somebody very close to you, like maybe your own kids or your nephews or nieces or something, because you have a relationship, they might, you know, take it from you. But in general, young people today, oh my God, it's a big challenge to deal with them. So I would take a roundabout approach. I would take an indirect approach, and I would take an approach where it's like a team effort. So it's not just you. You could have a few Matajis, you could have a few Prabhus, some people whom young people really gel with or like very much, you know, have some popular, you know, they're always in a particular temples, there are one or two Matajis or Prabhus who get along very well with the young people, rope them in and say, I would like to do this as a service, and then organize something where they can actually come in and get a very concentrated dose of what you're trying to say. Because once they're in the room, you've got a captive audience. You know, they're coming ready to hear something important. I think that will be more effective. Does that make sense?
Yes, Mataji. No, I think... No, yes, it does, Mataji. Thank you. I know it's difficult in the sense to encourage them, but yes, that's a good idea. Thank you.
I'll think about it some more, and if Guru and Krishna inspire me with something, I will certainly let you know.
Sure, Mataji, sure. But also, Mataji, not just with the newcomers, we also find this somebody with people who have been there with ISKCON within the congregation as well. And nowadays, yeah, because of the presence of the social media, mm-hmm, there is so much on the media, and people start thinking mentally that is substituting for reading, proper reading. Mm-hmm. There are quotes from Srila Prabhupada that so many devotees circulate. There's always something on Facebook that there's quotes available from other, you know, Shiksha Gurus and Diksha Gurus. And so I think mentally people also substitute that for reading. A snot snippet, a 5-minute video here and there. And so that is also something that we are struggling with, at least, or at least some of the devotees who are heavy into preaching with Bhakti Vriksha Group. I see that a lot.
Definitely, definitely. It is very, very distracting, you know, weapons of mass destruction going around. And there are many of us who are lazy also. Let's face that. You know, we don't want to make the effort. We want easy, something spoon feeding. We think that, okay, I'll just take something easy. But easy life and Krishna consciousness don't go together. Prabhupada said that. There's no easy way to do this. There's only one way, and that's the hard way. And lessons learned the hard way, we never forget it. I know what you're talking about, because I've seen people 30, 40 years in the movement, and they go and listen to this Kripalu Maharaj and that Sadguru, and they try to take a Bhilpuri approach, you know, from here, there, everywhere, take something. I don't know what we can do in that situation, because we are not their Shiksha Gurus, or we are not, maybe you are, because you're conducting Bhakti Shastri, so, I mean, Bhakti Vriksh. So you are in a position to guide them. You know, it's actually cheating yourself ultimately if you're trying to take the, you know, quick and easy, you know, everything quick and easy approach. You're actually cheating yourself of the real deal. So by Krishna's mercy, they will realize, I think, after some time that, hey, I'm not getting really a taste. I'm not feeling joyful. I'm not feeling happy. I'm not feeling blissful. Probably by association, they will understand that I'm not doing something right. It has to come from within, you know, that why am I not making progress? Why am I not feeling the bliss? Why am I so restless all the time? Why are my anarthas not going away? What am I doing wrong? We have to be very introspective. And how many people are willing to be introspective? Not many. So sometimes we may just have to say, Krishna help you, brother, and leave it at that, because we have no control over that situation. We have no relationship with them. We have no influence over them. We cannot say anything. But if we are, then we can, in a gentle way, try to bring them back, you know, try to encourage them to go deeper into Prabhupada's teachings, try to take them closer to Prabhupada in some way. I think the best example, Diptesh Prabhu, is you being a good example. There is no substitute for that. I remember asking our GBC, because I saw so much around me, it used to disturb me so much. And I told my GBC, what do I do about the situation? Look at people, how they are. They don't come for the program. They don't chant their round. They just show up for prasad. And he said, you be a good example. You be the change you want to see. Finish. That was it. He silenced me. And there was so much work to do right there. I said, all right, better if I just focus on my Krishna consciousness and stop worrying so much about others. Krishna will take care of them. So I don't think I'm satisfying you. I'm just...
No, Mataji. This is good. No, thank you. Thank you. No, I think it's... No, thank you for that discussion and answer. And Mataji, just for clarification of the doubt here, because the call has also been recorded, so I want to clarify that I'm not a leader of a Bhakti Vriksha group, but I was referring that I know some devotees who are leading Bhakti Vriksha groups, and when we have discussions around general things, that's what I come across, that, you know, they're struggling in reading, and people want to take the shortcuts, and then not understanding the philosophy properly, and then not progressing well. But, no, thank you, Mataji.
Yeah, right. It is very challenging for Bhakti Vriksha leaders. You know, they have such a big responsibility to guide absolute, you know, neophyte people and be very gentle, very compassionate, very kind, very patient, very tolerant, very thoughtful, very considerate, understand their situation. I would say strong relationships, you know, building strong relationships with them. And then just being the best devotee you can be, just being the best example you can be. What else can you do? You know, and praying a lot for them, praying for them to be helped.
Yes, Mataji, thank you. I think what you said, I don't want to stretch the point, but what you said here is the most important thing that I've found out in the last two years, I would say. Is that relationship. They come and they listen and they want to progress because of that relationship that you have. And that building that relationship takes time, because that means listening to their material problems, listening to any other problems they have.
Yes.
And regularly making sure that you are circling back with them with a phone call about, hey, how's things are going? Yes. And I've realized that, you know, when I was speaking to family and friends, you know, it does take a lot of your time.
Yes. A lot of time, a lot of energy, and a lot of your you know, emotional energy also to listen to all this, and a lot of spiritual energy to just stay with that negativity, you know, whatever they're throwing at you. It is very hard. So it calls for a lot of strength and a lot of determination and courage and strong sadhana. I cannot stress how important sadhana is. If we have to guide others, we have to have very strong sadhana, because then Krishna will give us some intelligence. And of course, Diptesh Prabhu, you are completely welcome to ask all these questions tomorrow to Guru Maharaj to get complete answers. You know, I'm just sharing what little bit I know, which is not much. I apologize.
No, Mataji, I think you have experience, and I think that also is quite helpful because, no, they have been satisfying Mataji's answers. So thank you for it.
Thank you for asking such deep questions that is provoking a lot of discussion and as well as some thinking for me too. Thank you very much. My humble obeisance.
Thank you, Hare
Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. That was a wonderful class and very nice answers to the questions. Sudha Mataji has raised hand. Mataji, please go ahead.
Yeah. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. My humble obeisances.
Hare Krishna. Danu Pranam, Mataji. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Mataji, thank you so much for explaining the importance of reading and applying and the association of book Bhagavata and devotee Bhagavata. So Mataji, I have a question about like applying. So I mean, sometimes even though like we engage in reading, listening from the pure devotee, doing sadhana and all that. So when it comes to application, even though we understand it, we find it very hard to in applying them. So I'm just trying to understand, like application is also does it depend on the mercy of the Lord?
Well, everything depends on the mercy of the Lord, without a doubt. Every single thing depends on the mercy of the Lord. So it's a very general question. Would you be able to share what specific area of application you're looking at?
Like in general, like when it comes to like, you know, doing Mangalati in the morning, waking up, and in general, like situations when we are when we encounter any situations, like how to handle those situations. Even though we regularly do sadhana, reading and all those things, and as a neophyte, maybe I'm finding it very hard. So I'm just trying to understand, like application also depends on the mercy of the Lord, like that.
Yes, definitely. We need mercy of the Lord. We need mercy of his pure devotee. We need the mercy of Vaishnavas. So prayer would help. And association, basically we get a lot of strength from association, like birds, you know, flying in a flock. Each is actually helping the other, you know, when they're flying in formation, each bird gives strength to the other birds and they gain strength from the other birds. So it's a mutual thing. So association helps, prayer helps, writing to the spiritual master and getting his guidance is very beneficial and very necessary in our spiritual life. And desire. If you have a sincere desire, I really want to wake up a Mangalati, my dear Lord, please help me. Please give me intelligence, how to manage my day, how to manage my energy, how to manage my duties, how to manage my schedule in such a way that I can rest early, wake up early, and so on. You start, you know, making efforts in that direction by intention, by prayer, and then getting guidance, getting association. Slowly, little by little, you will see yourself moving in that direction. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know if this is any use to you, but when I first came to Krishna consciousness, I was struggling to just chant rounds. It was such a struggle to chant. Then the next struggle was rising early in the morning. That was another big struggle. But in my heart, I always kept praying. I said, my dear Lord, I really want to wake up early. I really want to come for Mangalarti. I really want to do, you know, and little by little, over a period of time, that desire got blessed by the Lord, that I was actually able to rise early morning. I was actually able to go for Mangalarti. But it took time. It took a few years to get to that point. It took me 4 years to come from 2 rounds to 16 rounds, you know? 2001, and I got initiated, 4 years. So it didn't happen overnight. It happened over a period of time. So just be patient and keep praying to the Lord to help and keep trying to move in that direction. As long as you're trying to move towards that direction, even if you're taking a little baby step, Krishna becomes so pleased and he takes many, many steps towards you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Mataji. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mataji. So continuous prayer, and we should have a desire in the heart. And association, all these things will help eventually, like to come to that stage.
Right. And, you know, write your desires down in black and white and stick them on the wall so that you can see them every day and you can ask the Lord to bless that desire. Because when something is in black and white and it is staring at you, it plays on your mind, you know. I want to get up early for Mangalarti. I want to get up early for Mangalarti. Every time you're passing by up and down that room, where you sit and chant or whatever, you're saying, I want to get up early for Mangalarti. Slowly your mind starts moving in that direction. Your thoughts start moving. How can I finish my chores early today? How can I get to bed? Remember, Mangalarti happens the day before. If we want to rise early today, we should do all the work yesterday. So if we want to wake up early for Mangalarti, we have to get to bed early. For that, our day has to be programmed in such a way that we go to rest at a decent hour. Then we can rise early morning. So constantly meditating on that intention, praying to the Lord, writing to the spiritual master, seeking the association of people who are doing Mangalarti, that will all help you to move towards that goal. This is just my humble take. If you like, please ask Guru Maharaj, and that will be the best answer you will get.
Hare Krishna. No, Mataji, very nice advice you gave. Definitely, as you said, like constantly meditating on that and writing down on a piece of paper. And these tips, definitely, I think I will try and I'll work on that, Mataji. Thank you so much for your suggestions.
Yeah. And then you can also do one more thing. You can look at what you will do when you will be doing Mangalarti. Like say, when I actually wake up early, I will be chanting these prayers. So start looking at the Gurvashtakam prayer. Start looking at the, and Gurvashtakam prayer is so beautiful. Just by reading those prayers and reading the translations in the songbook. You have the songbook of Vaishnava Acharyas with you?
Yes, Mataji. Yeah, I do.
Yeah. So start looking at those beautiful Gurvashtakam prayers. Prayers to the spiritual master. Start reading them, even at other times, you know, read them in the evening, read them in the afternoon. Try to absorb that mood of praying to the spiritual master. Then look at the next prayer, that is Narsingadev prayer. Look at the next prayer, which is Tulsi Arti. Look at the Shikshashtakam prayers. It doesn't mean that just because you're not rising early for Mangalarti that you cannot chant these prayers. You can chant these prayers at any time, as a preparation for the time when you will chant them for Mangalarti. So chant Shikshashtakam. Look at the 10 offenses every time you sit down to japa. Maybe you sit down to do japa in the afternoon. Doesn't matter. You pretend that it is Mangalarti time and you recite the 10 offenses and say, I will not do these 10 offenses. I'm sitting down to chant. And that will get you in the mood of Mangalarti slowly, by and by. And one fine day you will say, wow, I'm waking up for Mangalarti. It's a process, but keep trying.
Okay. Yes, Mataji. Yeah, thank you for the wonderful tips. Definitely, I'll try these tips, Mataji. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
And if I can think of something else further, I will also meditate and pray over your question. If something else comes by mercy of Guru and Krishna, I will certainly share it with you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mataji. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. It was again wonderful. Even I'm struggling for Mangalarti, so I think these tips will really help me. Thank you, Mataji.
You know, we can do Mangalarti online. In fact, we have been doing Mangalarti online for some time now. Of course, it's a very short version, just 30 minutes.
Okay.
We can talk more about it later if you like.
Sure, Mataji, sure.
Are there any other questions, comments, realizations, thoughts, corrections, advice? I'm your humble servant. I need corrections and advice too. So please give it to me. Or if there's nothing, we can end the class. Is that okay? Vrinda might like to. 5 minutes over time. Isn't it, Vrinda? For you, it's getting late?
No, it's 12:05, Mataji. It's not very late.
Okay.
But if there are no more questions or comments or anything, with your permission, shall we end the call?
Yes. We will just offer our humble obeisances. Vanja kalpatabhyo. Sindubhyay vaja patita nam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. Guru Maharaj ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. And all glories to our dear brother Janakinath Prabhu ki jai.
Jai. Hare Shri Devi Mataji ki jai.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Vishwapavani. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Shri Mataji. It was a wonderful classes. Thank you so much. Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, my dear brother. My humble obeisances to you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Sri Devi. Thank you for the wonderful class. So nice to hear from you. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, my dear Shyamarani. My humble obeisances to you, and Kushal.
Oh, sorry.
Hear your voice.
Haripal.
Thank you for coming on.
Oh, thank you.
Hare Krishna. Guru Maharaj ki jai. Thank you, Ivana. My obeisances to you too. Hare Krishna.
Okay, I will end the call, Mataji. Thank you once again. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Vrinda.